When Enoch had lived 65 years, he became the father of Methuselah. And after he became the father of Methuselah, Enoch walked with God 300 years and had other sons and daughters. Although Enoch lived 365 years, Enoch walked with God. Then he was no more because God took him away. Amen. To hear. Okay, this morning my sermon continues from the sermon that I preached last week. Last week we studied about Cain, the evil man, and people in his genealogy. You know, people in the genealogy of Cain were so evil, and they were wicked, even they were brutal. Their thoughts were evil, as well as their actions. They were the majority in the society, and they tried to build their own kingdom without God. They tried to remove God from every aspect of human life, and they created a kind of human-centric culture and society. And as I said last week, they used all possible means to divert people's attention from God to human beings. And this is happening nowadays. You know, people build their own kingdoms for their own fame, for their own power, for their own popularity. And people create human-centric cultures. It is about themselves. We sang, it's not about me, it is about you. We sang this morning, it is about Jesus. But now people create cultures and trends to say that it is about me, me. I am the center. Self is the center of everything nowadays. On the contrary, there were few godly people in the genealogy of Seth. Seth and his son Enosh were surrounded by evil people and wicked people. The name Enosh means, as you know, as you heard last week, Enosh means weakness, fragility, and vulnerability. Seth, he named his son Enosh, which means vulnerable. Seth, Enosh, you are a vulnerable people. It means they identified themselves as weak, fragile, and vulnerable in comparison with those in the genealogy of Cain, because they were so evil and powerful. But people in the genealogy of Seth, they were so weak in comparison with those people in the genealogy of Cain. In that situation, they found one thing that they could do to continually live godly life, to keep their faith in the land where lots of evil people were crowded. That was, they began to call upon the name of the Lord. In the evil land where so many wicked people were crowded, they found one thing to keep their faith and to continue to live their godly life. That was, they began to call upon the name of the Lord. In other words, they began to proclaim the name of the Lord. It means that they began to have a public worship in the land where evil people were crowded. They worshipped God in their weakness, in their fragility, in their vulnerability. That is what we do here in this place. And the amazing thing is that God continued his redemption history with these weak people, vulnerable people, and fragile people. It's a mystery. God chose the weak things in the world to shame the strong. Okay, God chose the foolish ones to to shame the wise. This is what God does. That's why I am chosen. That's why you are chosen. We are foolish. We are weak. So God loved us. He came to use us for His glory. Hallelujah. We are living in the exactly same social and cultural context nowadays. We are minority. You know, if we were to touch you the town center of Seoul, in this time, there are people crowded, you know, in the shopping center. But we are minority here. Gathering together as a family of God to praise Him. We are weak. Even we may say we are vulnerable. But we can proclaim the name of the Lord in this place. We can worship God without seeds until the Lord comes back. And this place should be run until the Lord comes back to praise God, to worship Him every week. Yeah. That is my prayer. That is my prayer. In this way, God will continue His redemption history through us, through this church. And this is what we can do collectively as Christians in this evil and wicked generation. So we are living in this wicked and evil generation. What we can do collectively as Christians, we come here once a week, twice a week, even more, to proclaim the name of the Lord, to say that the Lord is good. He is reigning. He is ruling over. He is in charge in the history.
Yes.
Proclaim that He is living God. That is our mission statement in this place. Collectively, we can do that. And today, I'm going to speak about what we can do as Christians in our personal, individual Christian life in this wicked and evil generation. I'm sure that we can find the answer in the life of Enoch. Enoch lived a short life in comparison with other people at the time. He lived only 365 years. Do you want to live this much long? 365 years. But actually, it was only one third of lifespan of other people at the time. You know, at the time, the average lifespan was about 800, 900. So people lived that much long. But you know, it doesn't matter how long we live. Do you want to live long? There was one lady from Jamaica in our church, in my former church, and she sang this song. Everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die. Everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die. That is human nature. But it doesn't matter how long we live. What really matters is how God evaluates our lives. That is a really important thing. Although he lived a short life, Enoch is regarded as one of the greatest men of God in the whole human history. Do you agree?
Yes.
Yes, yes. The Bible evaluates his life like this. First of all, he walked with God. Are you walking with God? He walked with God. What does it mean? He had intimate relationship with God. Very much close, intimate relationship. And he understood the will of God and he obeyed every single word. Do you live this kind of life? That was one first evaluation of God about his life. The second one, he pleased God. Does your life please God? He did only things that pleased God. He refrained from evil cultural and social practices of the time. When others sought sensual pleasure and self-indulgence, he sought spiritual satisfaction by walking with God. When everybody was following the social cultural trends of the time, he rejected all those things and he walked with God. In that way, he pleased God. You know, walking with God in Enoch's time was as hard as we struggle in this present generation. Some people may think that, oh, I think walking with God in Enoch's time was easier than now because there was no strong temptation, as we have nowadays. There was no strong opposition, there was no strong persecution in the same way that we are facing them in this 21st century. But that is wrong assumption. I wanted to turn your Bible to Jude. Jude is the second last book in the Bible. Look at verse 14. Jude 14. Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men. These men are evil men at the time. See, the Lord is coming with thousands upon thousands of his holy ones to judge everyone and to convict all the ungodly of all the ungodly acts they have done in the ungodly way and of all the harsh words that ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These men are grumblers and fault finders. They follow their own evil desires. They boast about themselves and flatter others for their own advantage. See, the society was full of ungodly people. Even maybe, I think, more evil than now. You know, the society, the area where they lived was full of ungodly people, evil people, whose actions were driven by their evil desires. That is what the Bible says about the time and the society. Their speech was ungodly and harsh. They despised God and they boasted about themselves. They introduced all evil ways of life to the society. So together, all together, they became sinners. See, the social and spiritual atmosphere of the society at Enoch's time was not easy to walk with God. Simply, Enoch was alone, and his few family members were isolated by the majority of people who were evil, absolutely evil. They do not have any concept of God. They do not have any concept of holiness in their life. They did what they wanted to do according to their sinful desires. So can you imagine this small, you know, number of people struggling, vulnerable, weak, isolated completely, and mocked and ridiculed by the majority. That was Enoch's life, but he didn't care. He walked with God. The social environment didn't support him to walk with God at all, but he did. He walked with God. How he was able to walk with God in that situation? What was the secret? There is a hint in verse 22. If we come back to Genesis chapter 5, verse 22, it says, after he became the father of Methuselah, Enoch walked with God 300 years and had other sons and daughters. This is a hint, I think, about how he was able to walk with God in that evil environment. Enoch began to walk with God after having Methuselah. That is very clear in the verse. It seems that the birth of Methuselah is related to the reason why Enoch began to live and walk with God. So I have done a study to find the reason, and I have found two theories. I say theories, not the facts. Okay, the first theory is like this. Methuselah was quite weak and he was ill when he was born. And I could not find, you know, what kind of disease he had actually when he was born, but he was really weak and he was dying. Probably, this is my guess, that's, you know, probably he was a premature baby. So when he was born, he was quite sick and ill, and you know, organs in his body were not growing fully. So he was in danger, and people around the family said he was going to die soon. That was his status. Hearing that, observing his child, Enoch didn't have any way to save his child's life. So he began to pray to God for his son Methuselah. And God heard his crying. Can you imagine, you know, his child was dying, so he cried upon the name of the Lord in his prayer. God heard his cry, and God healed him, and he became a strong boy, and eventually he lived the longest life. This is one theory that I could find in different books and according to different scholars. But I don't have any interest in this theory at all, okay? And I want to introduce you the second theory. When Methuselah was born, Enoch had a revelation of God. And God delivered a clear message about his judgment through the revelation. The prophecy of Enoch that we read in the book of Jude was based on the revelation of God at the time, I think. And because of the revelation, Enoch named his son Methuselah. Do you know what is the meaning of Methuselah? Okay. If you know the meaning of his name Methuselah, you know what kind of revelation he had from the Lord. Methuselah means God will send a judgment after his death. Very clear. Very clear. God will send a judgment after Methuselah's death. That is the meaning of his name. After his death, God will send a judgment. In a short phrase, judgment after death. That is the meaning of his name, Methuselah. In fact, the flood of Noah came just after Methuselah's death. I mean that the two events, the Methuselah's death and the flood, happened in the same year. Of course, the death of Methuselah was prior to the flood of Noah. Some biblical scholars say that there was only 7 days gap between the death of Methuselah and the flood of Noah. And their assertion is based on chapter 7, verse 4. Look at chapter 7, verse 4. It says, 7 days from now, I will send rain on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, and I will wipe from the face of the earth every living creature I have made. Now God spoke to Noah to go into the ark 7 days before the flood. And these scholars, they believe that God spoke to Noah to go into the ark on the day when Methuselah died. Because that was the meaning of his name, Methuselah. God will send judgment after his death. Amazing, amazing. So if you look at chapter 7, verse 10, it says, and after the 7 days, the flood waters came on the earth. 7 days after Methuselah died, God sent the flood water to punish every single person, the evil ones on earth. According to the second theory, Enoch began to walk with God because, first of all, he had a revelation of God around the time when Methuselah was born. He had a revelation of God. The second one, through the revelation, he knew that there would be a judgment of God. Very clear. Can you imagine his life before the revelation? Before he had, you know, a revelation of God, can you imagine his life? He knew God. He believed in God, I think. Although he knew God, he didn't walk with God. Although he believed in God, he did not please God, maybe. But after that revelation, he began to walk with God and he pleased God. I think most of Christians not only UK, but also everywhere. They live this kind of life. The life that Enoch had before he had the revelation of God. He believed, but he didn't walk God. He knew God, but he didn't please God. And many people who are claiming that they are Christians, they live this kind of life. I know God, but I do not walk with God. I believe in Him, but I do not please Him. This is the life that Christians live nowadays. And Enoch lived in that way. But after that revelation, when God visited him, when God manifested himself to him to deliver a message about the judgment of God, his life was totally changed. The message in the revelation about the judgment of God was so clear, so real. So he began to walk with God. What were the results of his godly life? First one, he was taken up to heaven without death. He was so close to God. He lived on earth as if he was with God in heaven. You know? I think this is the definition of Christian life. He lived on earth as if he was with God in heaven. You know? That is the meaning of walking with God, actually. You know? I want to live this kind of life. I live physically on earth, but I want to live as if I am with God in heaven. Is it possible? The Bible says it is possible. It is possible. Let's live this kind of life. Do you feel God's presence? Oh, you know, Stuart, before we started our worship, he said it. Although we couldn't see our God with our physical eyes, when we were going through difficulties, he was with us, just next to us, talking to us, encouraging us, using all kinds of means to support us. That is our God. Is it possible that we can live with Him as if we are with Him in heaven? It is possible. Let's do that. John Wesley believed it. John Wesley, he believed Christians' sanctification. Hallelujah. So, there was no reason for him to live as long as others live on earth. His life was one third of other people's lifespan. All the, you know, if you read the church history, all the good and faithful Christians, they died earlier. You know, I know several good saints in Korea. I mean, not in Catholic saints. You know, the real good faithful Christians, they died before 30 years. Actually, they walked with God. They prayed. You know, their the spiritual gifts were so powerful, you know. God healed people through them, and whenever they preached, actually, people responded to the word of God in many different ways. So they have the wonderful things in church ministry, but actually, God took them earlier. They died around 30s. I don't know if I live long. There was no reason for him to die and wait until the Lord comes back to be raised among the dead. So he was taken up to heaven without experiencing death. The second one, he became a good example. So his children and children's children, they lived a godly life as well. I think whenever Enoch saw his son Methuselah, he spoke to like this: Methuselah, bear this message in your mind all the time, okay? And you have to pass it to your children and children's children through generations to generations. Remember, when you die, a judgment will come. And that is the meaning of your name. Don't forget it. Whenever you are called by people, Methuselah, judgment after death, remember the message of God. And don't bear in mind only yourself, but also pass it. Pass this message to your children and children's children. So people in my generation, in my family line, they have to remember God. They have to live with God. They have to walk with God. And he lived an exemplary life. In our Methuselah, he had a psalm called Lamech. And Enoch spent 113 years with him before he was taken to heaven. For 113 years, whenever Enoch saw Lamech, what did he speak to his grandson? Lamech. Lamech, remember, 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 God is going to judge people. Although they are the majority, they are creating the ungodly, evil culture in the society. They are making different trends and they are building their own kingdom. Forget about me. You don't know about me. You have to think about who God is, what He is going to do soon after your father's death. Remember, remember, judgment is coming. It is on the way now. That is His message. Methuselah, Lamech, they lived godly life. And their life influenced Noah. Noah, as you know, Noah lived a godly life. He walked with God. He was a righteous man among the people in the land. And only him and his wife, three sons and their wives, eight people on the earth were saved through Enoch's godly life. He became a good example. How can we walk with God in this wicked generation? I want us to bear two things in our mind today. First one, we have the greatest revelation, that is Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus came to this earth, although He was equal with God. He lived on earth and died on the cross for our sins. He rose from the grave to conquer death. Enoch had only partial revelation of God, but he began to walk with God. We have the full revelation of God through Jesus Christ, so we must walk with God. Enoch had a partial revelation of God, not full, but he began to walk with God. We have Jesus Christ, who is the full revelation of God, and we must walk with God because we have the full revelation of God through Jesus Christ. We need to walk with God. Crucify, we have to crucify our sinful nature with its passions and desire on the cross. We have to focus on Jesus Christ, the full revelation of God, who is the author and perfecter of our faith. We have to set our minds on things above, not things on earth. As Paul said, he died every day. We have to die every day in Christ Jesus. In that way we can walk with God. Jesus is everything. Jesus is everything. The one who has the Son has everything. You know? I like this old hymn. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I like silver or gold. And especially women, you know. In Korea, there are many women Christians. I think 70% of church members are women. And they like heaven because of sparkling, you know, gemstones there. I like, people like gold and silver. But I want to say, I'd rather have Jesus than gold or silver. I'd rather be His than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by His nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything that this world offers today. I want to have Jesus Christ and anything that this world can offer to me today. And this is our confession as well as Christians. If we have Jesus Christ, we have more than enough. As we sang this morning, we have more than enough. What do we need more? King David, he wrote Psalm 23, and he said in the first verse, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be want." And do you know the background of this psalm? Do you know when David wrote this psalm? When he was fled from his own son, Absalom. Absalom rebelled against him, and he was chasing to kill his father. And he was crying and fleeing from Jerusalem. At the time, he wrote this psalm. Can you imagine here? A father is escaping from his own son, chasing him. But he says, Lord, I don't care anything what is happening in the world. The Lord is my shepherd. You are my shepherd. I shall not be want. I do not have anything that I want because I have God, my Father, as my shepherd. He is leading me. He is guiding me. He is with me every day in my ups and downs. When I go through even the shadow of darkness, death of shadow of darkness, He is with me. He is supporting me. He is guiding me today. We have got Jesus Christ in our lives, the full revelation of God. And this is the strong reason that we can walk with God. He is with us. Second reason that we can walk with God is that through the gospel of Jesus, we know that there will be the final judgment of God at the end of the world. Enoch knew that there was a judgment soon. So he began to walk with God. And we know that there will be a judgment of God at the end of the world. So we have to walk with God. There will be the final judgment of all people living and dead. There will be no exception. There will be no way to escape from it. Even Satan and his followers will be judged and thrown into the eternal fire. Hallelujah. Even they will be thrown into the fire. Do not be deceived by false teachers saying that there will be no judgment or hell. There are many preachers saying that there will be no judgment or there will be no hell at all. Because God is good and His love endures forever. And this is half true. This is only half true. God is also just, and His justice will be fulfilled through the final judgment of God. Heaven and hell are real. The final judgment is coming. It is on the way. We all need to stand before the King, and we have to give our accounts one day before Him. Enoch, he began to walk with God through a revelation and through the message from God about the flood, the judgment. We have Jesus Christ, the full revelation of God, and we know that there will be a judgment of God at the end of the world. Let us walk with God in this wicked, in this evil generation. Forget about what they are doing. Don't look at it. But focus on God, on Jesus Christ, who was, who is, and who will be with us. Let's please God through our lives. If Enoch lived with God, and if Enoch walked with God in that evil and wicked social context and environment, we must walk with God in this evil and wicked generation. God will help us. God will help us. Let's live as if we are with God in heaven. Let's pray together.